Welcome everybody to this very happy event where David Jürgen will present his master project. Welcome to David's parents and all his friends and colleagues here. There are also friends out there on the live stream. Welcome to them also. Special welcome to Wendy Yu, who is remotely here from Palo Alto, I heard. And possibly also Vanessa Evers is here via live stream following us. I'm substitute here for her to chair this session for this presentation. So David will tell us what he has been doing the past half year to do.
Okay, first of all, thank you all for coming. I really appreciate that so many people showed up, and it's interesting to see people that I know since the beginning of creating, people that I've met like a couple of weeks ago. So that's amazing. Thank you all for coming. I spent the last year basically working on these things, and this keep them coming in, that's fine. I spent the last year, I started in January last year at Stanford University, to work on a project to get virtual reality to work inside of the car, and to do that especially as a research platform for autonomous vehicles. Now, I want to go back a bit and talk a bit about why it is necessary for us to actually investigate into new methods to work on cars, or to investigate these topics of behaviors of autonomous vehicles. And I thought I'd just start with a very famous comic, at least in that context. So, here really the idea is that autonomous cars are in many ways a very different kind of technology that people are going to have to interact with. Even if it's something that is physical and is moving, like an automated door or maybe a vending machine that moves in front of you, it is very much contained in its own space and it's very safe. It's very clear what the system is doing. However, once you enter kind of the traffic environment, these things change radically because you cannot really predict what the car is going to do necessarily because the next state of the car is not clear. And so we need to understand and evaluate these systems with much more care also to the dynamic behavior of them. You guys, you can just sit down, that's fine. You don't need to stand. But we have one fundamental problem with this, which is that this technology doesn't really exist yet, right? So we're trying to design for something, we're trying to understand the behaviors and interactions between people and this technology, even though it doesn't really exist yet. So we need to define and hello Vanessa, sorry. So we need to define and find methods that allow us to actually test these things in a safe and quick way. So they don't exist yet. What is the best next thing that we could do? Well, we could basically fake it. We could create things and allow us to create an experience as if someone would be driving in an autonomous car. And that is not something that is very clearly new, this kind of approach to create a kind of a fake environment or a believable environment. We've done this for a long time, but there are a few new things that come with autonomous vehicles that we'll talk a bit about later. One of the things that we really want to have a look at is, that we really want to stress, is the realism of these experiences. So, what we're interested in is getting the naturalistic response from people, right? We really want to know how they naturalistically would behave in a traffic scenario. What would they actually do if the autonomous car does something that they're not convinced about, or that they don't understand, or you know, maybe understand that something is odd about. So we really need to have a naturalistic understanding of these things. And the way that we do this is by basically trying to create a very realistic realistic experience for the participant. And I just want to quickly move through these words so you understand what I mean by them when I talk about them in the presentation. So we really want to create a realistic experience where most of the sensory input, so this is like vision, this is acoustics, this is tactile, this is maybe motion, that most of them are as real as possible to the actual experience, which then leads to a higher level of immersion, which makes it easy for the participant who is part of the study to suspend their disbelief, right? So this is what we're expecting, that the participant basically can suspend their disbelief that they're actually driving, that they really think that they're actually driving in an autonomous vehicle, so that they can actually also naturalistically then react to scenarios that happen. So this is why you always want to aim for a high level of realism in the environment that you're testing in. And so one way that has been done for autonomous cars is through simulators. So this is a picture of the simulator at Stanford. You see here there's a car chassis that doesn't move at all. Inside a big room where there's a 270 degree projection all around. So you can sit in the car, you can steer the car, you control it, and you feel like you are there. But even this method is somewhat limited in a way that it doesn't capture, for example, the motion that someone is feeling inside the car when driving, or inside an autonomous car when that would be driving. There are expensive attempts to make that work. So this is an example from the National Driving Simulator at the University of Iowa. There's the same setup where there's a car inside a big dome that is projected all around, but then they put the dome onto a pod, onto a robotic system that allows them to actually move it around. This is like the high-end, as high as it's going to get, simulators that can simulate the motion inside a vehicle. These things are, I think, no doubt, those are very expensive technologies. So this is one way where you can create the felt sense of driving in an environment. A different way is through on-road sites. So this is also a method that was also published and worked on by Wendy Ju's group at Stanford. And this is a RADS setup where the participant is sitting on the passenger side of the vehicle, here on the right side. I don't have a better picture, but you can see there's like a fake steering wheel also for the participant. But at the same time, there's also a partition between the participant and the actual driver. And it is made sure that the participant doesn't see that there's actually a driver. And through storytelling and making sure that you can create a believable story that this is indeed an autonomous vehicle, you can create the illusion that they're driving in an autonomous car. So this is basically an on-road experiment where you can see how people react if the car does certain things in the traffic environment. And I want to compare these two things a bit against each other, and I try to do this with a triangle. So driving simulators are amazing because you can test all kinds of scenarios, right? Anything that you can come up with, you can actually also test in a simulator. However, as I've hopefully demonstrated with the video, they are rather costly, and their realism is also dependent on how much money you can actually spend on it, because these motion-based simulators that move around are obviously very expensive. Then we have on-road experiments that are more affordable and have a very high level of realism. However, they're very restricted by the type of scenarios you can actually test, right? So you can only test things that frequently occur in a naturalistic environment. You cannot test any kind of critical handover scenarios or something like that, because that wouldn't be reasonably safe for you or the other road participants that are out there. So there is scenarios are somewhat limited. So my thesis then was to try to do this. We want to use the benefits that we get from on-road experiments, which is the naturalistic motion, the real feel that you're riding in an actual car, with the capability to actually simulate various different traffic scenarios, and try to find a balance between these trade-offs. So that was kind of the goal of VR and car. And I think as a first introduction, I'll quickly show you just a video of actually how what I made and how it looked in the end. So this is the first time where the system actually worked. And you see here, this is very similar to the setup of the on-road study again. So the driver is just sitting in the driver's seat, driving the car normally. The participant is sitting on the passenger side, wearing a virtual reality headset, and the experimenter sitting in the back, making sure everything works. At the bottom left here, you see what the participant is seeing. And here at the bottom right, this is sort of a bird's eye view on the car as it drives through the virtual world. So I'd like you to pay attention primarily to the left side of the screen, and you can see what the participant is seeing and his reaction to what's happening.
If I can find the play button.
Does this feel like kind of okay?
Yeah. Like, does it feel like I'm in a car?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Can you put your hands up for? Right. It just leaves them kind of center in your vision, and now you can just like if you jump straight, you
sure.
should be going this.
Oh, this is fucking weird. Oh god. Oh god.
You just. It was funny. Like there was a car hitting them in VR.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Oh god.
There
yeah,
was
we drove off the world.
Yeah.
So one thing we learned from that, I need to make the world a bit bigger. But the other thing was we could clearly show and that was actually in many ways an accident. I had cars driving around, but that it was going to hit at that exact moment was totally an accident indeed. But in general, we could show that we can create a believable experience with this technology. It is definitely also an affordable, so if I quickly go back to this slide, does that make sense? Yes, it does. So it is definitely affordable because you can utilize just off-the-shelf virtual reality technology. It is realistic in a way that we can, that we really just copy the motion of the vehicle so that what already exists and what is real, we can just copy over into the virtual environment. And given the physical space to drive around in, we are also relatively free in the kind of scenarios we want to test. So I quickly want to go just a bit into the technicalities of how this actually works. And this is a picture made by Wendy for the paper that we submitted. And it is actually a relatively simple tracking problem that we were trying to solve. So we needed to track where is the car, where is it pointing, and how fast is it going forward. If we know this, we can integrate its position over time, and we know where it is in the virtual world. And we do this by basically two pieces of technology. We have the OBD2 port, which is a port inside the car that allows us to ask the car, hey, how fast are you going? And the car gives us back in kilometers per hour how fast it's going. And we have an IMU in the car, which is something that every phone nowadays has, which tells you the orientation of the device. And with that, we can tell in what kind of orientation the car is. And with that, we can map the motion and the behavior of the physical car to the virtual car. Right, so we know in which direction it's pointing and how fast it's going forward. At the same time, we also know the position of the head from the participants through kind of the VR technology. Once through the deep motion, we know where the track hands are and where they should be. And also the Oculus Rift itself, so the virtual reality goggles, can also tell in which orientation the head is. There are some technicalities that I worked on trying to solve, but in the end, this is basically how the system mostly worked. Lost to understand. One more addition that now becomes also relevant for the next few slides is that in the final study we also actually included a gaming steering wheel in front of the participant. So even though in the video just now there was no steering wheel in front of the participant, in the study we actually had a steering wheel there. So an essential next step in trying to argue that this is actually something that we can use to do repeated experiments and was to validate this new method. And that is something which I have to say is not complete by far yet, but this is an initial validation study of the proof of concept implementation, right? So this was a small qualitative study with six participants. We had three different conditions where we wanted to test how people react if the autonomous car does something or does something where the participant is not sure if the autonomous car has actually understood the environment. Like, does the car actually understand what's going on? And we had, I'll talk a bit about what these are in a minute. And in the end, we had just semi-structured interviews to understand how the participant felt with the experience that they were getting. Did they really believe that they are in an autonomous car, or were there issues that caused them not to be able to suspend their disbelief? This is a lovely scene that we let them drove around in. So we start here at the bottom. Each of the conditions, let me start there. Each of the conditions starts here at the bottom, and we drive around the house. We drove around the center house, stopped here, and backed up into our reset position. For the normal condition, nothing happened. The car would drive around, we would be set. The second condition was an open door condition where this car's driver door would open just before the car from the participant would pass. And the last condition was that a similar looking car would cut off the car on that intersection. So you would approach it, and right when you would approach it, a car would just drive really fast in front of you. And we wanted to see if people would actually react in a way that they are afraid that the car was going to get hit either by the door or by the other car rushing by. So this is a virtual world, but we also need a space to drive the whole system. So this is what we did in front of the ice rink that is just behind the Twente Stadium. So this is the ice rink, this is the train tracks. And we basically started always here and then did our track like this. And then backed up here again. I tried to do a nice overlay, but nothing really worked out nicely. So we'll have to postpone that for a later point. So I also wanted to show you let's say the most successful experiment that we had with our first participant. This is the third condition, so the car is going to cut him off. And I really want you to pay attention to his arms and his reaction to the scenario that he's going to experience. So this is the first turn. Reflexive reaction to the car rushing by. It was not something that he thought about, I'm sitting here in a simulator, there's a car coming by, maybe I should do something. Now it was much more reflexive to a dangerous situation. And this is also how the participant described it later. It's a bit difficult to read because it was spoken. So in any way, so it was he reported it himself as being a reflexive reaction to the car rushing by. We were particularly interested during the experiments to understand how well people perceived the motion of the vehicle. So that was one of the questions that we asked. And another participant said that they really liked how the virtual and the real motion matched up. So it's not only how the car turns, but everything. Even also, the parking lot itself was not ideal because there were bumps and things, and you would actually feel the same motion that was happening in the real car. Also, you would see it in the virtual environment mapped. Interestingly, is also that some of the people interpreted that we wanted to hear about how the motion was perceived regarding the driving style of the autonomous vehicle. So one of the participants commented that the driver was a bit reckless. Which is interesting because it clearly shows that they were not concerned with talking about all the motion that they were perceiving in virtual reality, but it was more about the car and the driving behavior inside the car. But we also got, obviously, negative feedback. So graphic-wise, there's a lot of room for improvement, and especially this participant felt that it was way too gray and not nicely lit, and the houses were not very pretty. So this is definitely now a to-do for us in the future. Right. So now coming towards the end of the presentation, quickly want to discuss a bit of what we learned from these user experiments. And primarily is that a lot of the things we set out to do, so that the testing how well do people perceive the motion of the vehicle, how well do they can actually suspend their disbelief and feel that they are present, how well did that all work? And most of the people, or if not, all of the people five out of six people had an easy time to suspend their disbelief and felt oriented in the simulation. And all of these, like the motion, the visual and acoustic cues and the tactile cues were a good way for them to feel present there. One last thing that I didn't talk about in the beginning, but that's one of the aspects that is very relatively, it's not difficult, but it is an important point in the context of simulator work, is the topic of motion sickness, where if you see something, but your motion senses, your vestibular system reports no motion, then you can get motion sick, because there's a difference in what you see and what you feel. And that is one of the things that makes simulator research difficult at times. And so we were also curious if that would also apply for VR and CAR, for the work that I had now created. And it turns out that during the experiment, or right after the experiment, no one felt motion sick. However, about one hour after the experiment was done, a lot of participants came back and said, like, now I kind of feel weird. That's not quite right. And so that is something that we're definitely going to have to look at in future work, and something that we cannot really explain yet. Which brings us to future work. There are obviously a lot of technical improvements we can do. In many ways, this is a proof of concept implementation, looking at like basic sensors, basic virtual reality technology, what can we actually use to make this system work? And so we can look at better sensors or things that didn't really work. So there are visual aspects that we can improve, just in the visual quality, but then also in motion tracking and these kind of aspects. For the method itself, as a research method, the obvious next steps are better validation of this methodology. We need to compare it to static simulations. We need to create quantitative measures that allow us to verify the quality of the simulation, and things like that. Once these things are done, the technical improvement and the further validation of the method, we can have a look at actual research questions that we want to answer with this method. So one could be to look at using inertial motion as a signaling for autonomous vehicles. So how can we use the motion that the car has anyway to signal what the autonomous vehicle is going to do, so that it's not abrupt and that you understand what is going to happen? Another aspect would be to look at human behavior within the autonomous vehicle. So what happens if you're in a dangerous or in a critical situation, and how do people react to these kind of things? So for example, if you are, this is either a car cutting you off, or maybe even if you have to hand over control to the car or retrieve it back from the car, if it's a partially autonomous vehicle. Then we could use also this kind of method to look at design opportunities in this kind of space. There are obviously more points, but I'd refer to the report for those. In any case, that was it. I don't have a conclusion slide, but I think that's fine. Thank you, everybody, for listening.
Generating, let's say you want to crowdsource maybe the system, and some you would just, because there's millions of people driving in cars every day, you just give people the VR headset, plug it into the OBD port, just like that. Could you see that? Like, what would be need, or do you think there's value in that? Something like procedural generated VR traffic based on the input from the actual driver on the daily commute?
I haven't thought about it, to be honest, but that's definitely a possibility. So VR, the use of virtual reality in the car, as not as a research method, but as an entertainment kind of context.
You could also collect data that way, I guess.
That's true. Where do people look at? That's true as well. There's definitely a possibility. In many ways, this is a basic toolkit now on how to make that thing work. But I don't have, I have not thought about specific ideas in that regard.
Make a differentiation in ages?
There were different ages that we tested, but well, how do you mean?
No, you could imagine that maybe some people's reactions are different depending on their age group and how they would.
Definitely, that is something that we're going to need to look at.
Yeah.
Because I talked about that there was 5 out of 6 participants really had an easy time suspending their disbelief. Now, our oldest participant was the 6th. So there is an indication that that might be different with age groups, and so we definitely need to look at that if we want to further use it as a method.
They all have driver's license?
They all did. and be tested for that.
Could you imagine your environment working as a test case for narcotics?
Sure, yeah. Definitely, I think that would be very interesting. We also have thought about the idea to actually let the participant also drive the car, so actually sit in the driver's seat while wearing the VR headset. But right now, I think that's something that we'll have to postpone once we're more secure that the system actually works. Fairly reliable, more reliable than it does now. So, but it's like, you know, that is definitely one of the directions we could look at.
More questions? Are there questions from the committee? Wendy? Jamie?
Do you have any questions, Wendy?
One thing is, like, I think later on, I mean, one thing you mentioned was immersion. I was wondering if for later on, do you have ideas how you would measure immersion beyond just the anecdotal sense of immersiveness?
So what other measures I could think of that would allow us to measure the immersion of the participant? Is that correct?
Yeah.
I haven't thought or elaborated on that yet. But I think there are definitely, I think it would be interesting to look at qualitative measures, quantitative measures, just to see just the quality of the simulation, how good is that actually working. But then it would also be interesting to add more kind of points within the simulation, things to look at. Did people notice something? Just to see how present they actually are. Do they look at the things that are in the environment? I think that would be a first direction to go into, yeah.
More training questions?
Sorry, it was not to you.
Oh, okay. I was like, okay, no. How do you feel like the experience of the person actually entering a real vehicle influenced their experience with your system? Because there are some other systems that do, some of the ones that you showed, that do also give the vestibular cues, but they aren't actually entering a car that's driving around. So how do you feel like that influenced people's experience?
I'm sure this had a substantial impact on that, especially also because before we started the experiment, so we started the experiment here at the design lab, and then we drove to the ice rink, right? So they had experience that the car is actually driving, and it is a normal car. Because we drove there just normally without the VR headset, of course. So I think that helped a lot to sell the idea to them that they are sitting in a normal car, because they just driven in it, you know. So.
Other questions?
Yeah. In this case, you had like, the driver had the user had the wire, the swing wire, and then I was wondering how different it would be if you had someone who is getting on a taxi, for example, so they don't know the driver, but this driver behaves in the same way that in the experiment you have been you have had in your study. Mm-hmm. So do you think that it would be a very a lot of differences in the reaction of the users?
To the driving style, I mean.
Yeah.
Yes. So that I think, I mean, looking at driving styles is definitely a very important point. And that is also something that would be, that we would be able to investigate with that system further, because you can train the driver of the vehicle to have certain driving styles, be very aggressive or be, you know, very, very calm, and then we could evaluate how people react to that.
Yeah, but what I see, for example, is that in that case, the actual driver is there, so, but you don't have maybe the wheel.
Right.
So, if he's misbehaving, then there's no way to stop the car.
Right, but what do you do then? Right. So that would, I think, I mean, that's kind of a provocative study, but it would be super interesting to do, to see what people do if they have no way of intervening with an autonomous vehicle. I mean, do they just step out or start screaming? What's happening? You know, what are people going to do? And especially if we then give them different kinds of interfaces, be it a touch screen or a Siri-like voice interface, I don't know. We could really evaluate how people would react to not being able to be in control.
I was wondering, like, you briefly talked by answering your first question about other uses of VR in a car. I was wondering if this study, because of your motion tracking of the car also itself and stuff, could help creating very different VR experiences in the car. I'm thinking maybe of an airplane or a train or another thing in motion, which actually the real motions of the car help you with the entertainment in the virtual reality.
Yes, and that has to a certain extent it has been done. use VR, so there have been publications this year on using virtual reality in the car as a tool to alleviate motion sickness. So some people just get already motion sickness driving in the car normally. And the question was, if we add additional visual cues of the motion of the vehicle in something like a virtual environment or 360 video, then would the motion sickness go down? That was kind of their approach. But there are definitely a lot of kind of entertainment focused applications of this technology, definitely. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Since you wanted to make it as realistic as possible, did you also make sure to get a car with the steering wheel on the opposite side of where you're supposed to be driving on the road, so that their steering wheel will be on the right side of the road?
Yes, actually. Not in this study, but in Stanford, in the second implementation that I built in Stanford, we used a right-hand drive Jeep, so that the participant would be sitting exactly where he also sits in virtual reality. That was now different, that was right. And so that is also the plan for the next step, is to use a right-hand drive vehicle so that they really feel they're sitting in the driver's seat, even though they're not.
How did you come to the selection of the scenarios? Is there some hypothesis on the behavior of the humans in the situation, difficult situations, or how did you select them?
You mean the three conditions, is opening
yes.
the door and the car cutting off? That was primarily creative brainstorming. Now it was more or less looking at something that wouldn't. So we wanted to have something where nothing happens, something where something severe could happen, and something in between. And so just out of looking at different scenarios that could conceivably happen in a virtual environment, we ran brainstorms at the CDR as part of a course there. And there were a lot of ideas also about, you know, going the wrong way around in a roundabout, or having bikers going the wrong way around in a roundabout. But we went just to take with the simple environments, because it's also like opening a car door is relatively simple to do compared to having a biker driving in virtual reality. So, you know, going with the simpler solution.
Okay. So, thank you. So then, no questions anymore then. Thank you again, David.
Yeah, and the